some saving up. I want to thank the youth for coming down on Friday night. We had a good time. Got t-shirts and cookies and chips. Wonderful singing and youth. Older people praise God with a hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, a waving of the hand. And I found out Friday night that youth don't praise God that way. They praise him with whipping it, is that it? In the name, that's how they get down. And I enjoyed seeing them do their thing. It was hot, but we had a good time. It was a wonderful time. Hot and cold out here. But we had a good time. Thank you, Pastor Dawkins and New Beginning Fellowship Church for introducing that event to us. They look to make it an annual thing. And hopefully, Bradford, that we will participate every year. And had a combined choir with New Beginnings Fellowship Church Choir, the Second Advent, some representatives from the Second Advent Choir, some representatives from Starlight, and they did a wonderful job, beautiful singing, and we even had a soloist in the group. Keanu grabbed the mic and said, let me show you how we do it at Second Advent. Grateful for that. We had a wonderful, wonderful time. I enjoyed myself, and that was parents and they're sitting way in the back. And, just observing the scene and everything went. But it was real God, wonderful, wonderful experience. So thank you. Thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to make sure your child got there. And I kept a good eye on them. They were well behaved and did nothing out of order. So it was a wonderful, wonderful time. Romans chapter 15. I got to get home and see the Warriors beat the Cavaliers tonight. I'm neither a Warriors fan, neither am I a Cavaliers fan, but I don't care nothing about LeBron James, so I go with the Warriors. Romans chapter 15, look with me briefly at verses 1 through 6. Romans chapter 15, if you keep it up. 16 chapters in the book of Romans. We started in chapter number 1. We finally making it to chapter 15. And we're moving slowly but surely. And I would encourage each and every one of you in your spare time, you would go back through the book of Romans and revisit some things that we have covered to make sure that this stuff stays fresh on your mind. But as I said in Wednesdays in the Word, if you have a thorough understanding of the book of Romans, you have a general understanding of the entire Bible as a whole. If you understand the book of Romans and you open Genesis through Revelation, you will have a general understanding of what is taking place, of what is being said. Romans chapters 1 through 11, Paul is very theological. When I say theological, that means that Paul gives us a very in-depth understanding of who God is and what God expects. Verses in chapters 12 through 16, Paul says, out of all that theology that I gave you in chapters 1 through 11, in chapters 12 through 16, now I'm going to tell you what you should do with that information. And that is a good diet for every Christian. To not only know what God expects, but to do what God expects in accordance with what you know. Today we're dealing with Romans chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. Trust that everyone has it. The Word of our God reads like this. Now we who are strong ought to bear the weaknesses of those without strength, and not just please ourselves. Each of us is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. For even Christ did not please himself. But as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Now may the God who gives perseverance and encouragement grant you to be of the same mind with one another, according to Christ Jesus, so that with one accord you may with one voice glorify the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to preach this morning from the subject, unified praise. You may have your seats. Thank you very much, ushers. You are certainly too kind. Unified praise. So that with one accord you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that with one accord and with one voice, you and I may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Unified praise. In most wedding ceremonies, there is a period in the service where the bride and the groom light what is referred to as what is commonly known as the unity candle. The unity candle essentially includes three candles. One big candle in the center, and two smaller candles, obviously one for the bride and the other for the groom. When this portion of the service is introduced, both the bride and the groom make their way to the unity candle. Both the bride and the groom light their own candle. And both of them together take their candle, and together they light the big candle in the center as a symbol that the two of them have become one. After the bride and the groom have both lit the unity candle, there is one of two things that they can do next. They can either extinguish their individual candles as a symbol that because they are united in holy matrimony, they have now become one person. But if they choose not to extinguish their candles, the other option that they have is that they can allow their candles to continue to burn as a symbol that although they are united in holy matrimony, they intend to operate as two different personalities. at a wedding, everyone was excited to see this young couple get married. Everybody was anxious to know how the couple would treat the unity candles. They wanted to know if the couple is going to extinguish their candles, or if the couple is going to allow their candles to continue to burn. When the part of the unity ceremony came in the service, the crowd went silent as the bride and the groom both lit their candles. The crowd was silent when both the bride and the groom took their candles to light the unity candle. And after the bride and the groom lit the unity candle, they both took their candles and put them back in their respective places, and they left them burning. The crowd gasped for air, wondering, why in the world is this couple allowing their candles to continue to burn? Don't they know that they are becoming one person? During the wedding reception, instead of enjoying the food and everything that the couple had prepared, there was whispers going on around the reception hall. People were saying this marriage will not last because they are not willing to give up themselves to be one person. The whispers continued to go around the wedding hall reception, and the wedding reception was over and everybody went to their houses. And 10 years later, that same couple that was married 10 years earlier had organized a second wedding to renew their vows that they had made 10 years earlier. When they got to the wedding reception, this time, instead of everybody whispering, a young man who was contemplating marriage stood up and asked the groom, what is the secret to your successful marriage? To which the groom responded by saying, that's easy. The secret to my successful marriage is that I have simply learned how to get along with a person who is nothing like me. In a real sense, ladies and gentlemen, I have discovered that if the church is going to praise the same God in the same place at the same time, it requires that we learn how to get along with people who are nothing like us. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, if the choir is going to sing together, it requires that the tenors learn how to sing with the altos, and the altos learn how to sing with the sopranos. It requires that we learn how to get along with people who are nothing like us. Therefore, the natural question that arises out of the text is, how do you praise God with all believers? How is it that you and I can unite ourselves with another body of believers who don't do things like we do? How is it that you and I can get along with another group of believers who prefer not to have musical instruments in their worship, but we do? How do you and I praise God together with all believers?
Here, in our selected text, the Holy Spirit makes known to us how it is that both you and I can praise God together with all believers. If you are going to praise God together with all believers, it requires first that you endure the limitations of other believers. If you graced us with your presence on last week, then you would have heard me preach a sermon entitled, My Brother's Keeper. It was inside that little sermon that the question was raised, how can you keep your brother from sinning against God? Or how can you keep other believers from sinning against God? And if you took good notes, then properly you learn that if you are going to keep your other believers from sinning against God, it requires that you watch your behavior. Not only does it require that you watch your behavior, it requires, secondly, that you pursue harmony with all believers. If you are going to keep other believers from sinning against God, not only does it require that you watch your behavior and that you pursue harmony with all believers, but lastly, we learn that you can keep your brother from sinning against God by refraining from questionable behavior. And it was based on that argument that Paul eases his way into Romans chapter 15, particularly verse number 1, by instructing those of us who are strong in the faith to carry those who are weak in the faith. Paul essentially says that there are two kinds of people in the church. Do you see it? There are those who are spiritually strong, and there are those who are spiritually weak. Paul lets us know that we shouldn't have color barriers in the church. Whether a person is Caucasian or African American shouldn't matter. Whether a person is financially stable or whether a person is financially unstable shouldn't matter. Paul says that is not the dividing lines that we have in the church. The dividing line that we have in the church is that there are weak believers and there are strong believers. Interestingly, if I go around the room, nobody would confess to be a weak believer. Everybody would say, I'm strong in the faith. But Paul says, you a lie and the truth ain't in it. Because the church is made up of two kinds of people. Weak people and strong people. Paul says it is the obligation of those who are spiritually strong to carry those who are spiritually weak. The Greek word that Paul uses for strong here is dynatos. The Greek word dynatos describes a person who understands spiritual things. A person who understands spiritual things is not easily shaken by life's bad hands. This is the way you can distinguish between a strong Christian and a weak Christian. Because when a weak Christian is going through hard times, they are ready to pull their hair out. But when a strong Christian is enduring difficult times, they just lift up their voice and quote Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd.
shall not walk. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters.
When a weak Christian is dealing with difficult times in their life, they don't have a praise to give God on a Sunday. But when a strong Christian is having trouble in their life, they are still lifting their hands in the sanctuary. Paul says, there are strong Christians and there are weak Christians. Paul uses the word strong in reference to a person who understands spiritual things. On the contrary, a weak person is a person who has limitations. Or it refers to a Christian who does not understand spiritual things. The Greek word that Paul uses for weak gives the picture of a person who is impotent. Impotent is a fancy way of saying a sick person. A sick person who is lying on their bed of affliction has certain limitations. They lay on their bed and they need someone to assist them. They need someone to bring them something to drink. They need someone to help them do certain things. Paul says a weak Christian is a person who has limitations. They can only go so far. But when a strong Christian comes in contact with a weak Christian, it is our obligation to help that weak brother or sister in whatever they need help with. But notice what Paul says. Paul says you shouldn't help them to please ourselves. Do you see that in your Bible? Now we who are strong ought to bear the weaknesses of those without strength, and not just to please ourselves. Literally, Paul is painting the picture of saying you shouldn't pick people up just because you can. Hear me, you should pick people up because you care. Tweet that correct. You shouldn't walk around carrying weak believers because you are strong enough to carry them. You should carry weak believers because you care about their well-being. Which one are you? First, you have to determine whether or not you are a strong or weak Christian. And if you find out that you are a strong Christian, you have to then determine what is your motivation for helping other people. Do you help people because you got a few extra dollars and you just need to give them something? Do you help the person on the corner asking for loose change because you had some change in your door handle that you wasn't using? Or do you help them because you care? Paul says, don't do it for yourself. Do it because you care. A weightlifter, generally speaking, has what gymnasts refer to as a spotter. A spotter is that person who stands behind the person who is lifting the weights. Understand the spotter's job. The spotter is not there to lift the weight for the weightlifter, but the spotter is there to encourage the weightlifter to lift the weight. And if at any time the weightlifter becomes in a position where they are struggling to lift the weight, the spotter is there to render aid to the weightlifter. Notice with me, if you will, I'm almost certain that no spotter or no weightlifter wants a spotter
who is weaker are on the same level as them. I don't want nobody helping me who is weaker than I am, and I don't want nobody helping me who is on the same level as I am. I need somebody helping me that's stronger than I am. Because if you're on the same level as me, if I start struggling, we both going down. But I need somebody who's stronger than I am to pick me up when I'm down. Paul says, it is the obligation of the strong in the faith to carry those who are weak in the faith. In verse 1, Paul instructs those of us who are strong to carry those of us who are weak. In verses 2 and 3, Paul reveals why the strong should carry the weak. Paul says in verses 2 and 3, each of us is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. Verse 3, why Paul? Because Christ did not please himself. But as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproach you fail on Christ. The number one reason that those of us who are strong should carry those who are weak is because Christ carried you when you couldn't carry yourself. That's motivation enough to help somebody who is helpless, because when you remember that you were once helpless, but Christ picked you up. Paul says that should be your motivation. The reproaches that were meant for you, Christ put them on him. You know what a reproach is, don't you? A reproach is that which is insulting. It refers to persecution. It refers to harm that was meant for you that Christ put on him. Let me help you. You and I were the ones who were sinners. The cross was meant for us. Those nails were meant for us. Those spikes were meant for us. That crown of thorns was meant for us. But because we were too weak to carry our own cross, Christ came off his throne in heaven and wrapped himself in a uterus of a virgin by the name of Mary. He stayed in that uterus 9 long months, came out a whining baby boy, but grew up a soul-saving man. All because we were too weak to carry the cross. So he carried it for us. When you keep that in your mind, when you come across a believer who is struggling with being a Christian, you ought to say, because Christ helped me, I'm going to help you. Paul validates why the strong should carry the weak by quoting Psalm 69, verse 9. Psalm 69, verse 9 is what biblicists refer to as a messianic psalm. It's a psalm that speaks about what Christ did for us. Our reproaches fail on him.
Isaiah 53 says it best, Christ was wounded for our transgressions. Christ was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon Christ. With his stripes, we are healed. Christ cared for us when we were too weak to care for ourselves, and that's why those of us who are strong should bear the burden of those who are weak. If, ladies and gentlemen, you are going to praise God with all believers, it requires that you learn how to endure the limitations of other believers. No, everyone is not strong. But for those of us who are strong, we have to endure the limitations of those who are weak. And if we successfully endure the limitations of those who are weak, we can praise God together with all believers. If we're going to praise God with all believers, it requires that we endure the limitations of all believers. Not only does it require that we endure the limitations of all believers, lastly, and I'm in my seat, it requires that we learn the word of God. Yes, we have to endure the limitations of all believers, but we have to learn the word of God. In verses 4, 5, and 6, Paul reveals to us that the word of God advocates unity amongst believers. Verse 4, Paul says, for whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Do you see the progression of the text? Paul says that what was written for our instruction, that we may be able to persevere and be encouraged from the scripture. I love this. The phrase, the scriptures there, is simply a reference to the entire Old Testament. Paul says that the scriptures contain encouragement that will allow you to persevere in hard times. Okay. This is cool because you've been waiting till you get to church to get a word. You've been waiting to hear the right song to lift up your head. But Paul says the scriptures encourage us to persevere. Just reading the word of God ought to lift up your head. Paul says you got to learn the word of God. Notice Paul's use of perseverance and his use of encouragement. The definitions of these words mean little to nothing here, as much as the grammatical features surrounding the word. Both the word perseverance and encouragement are nouns. They are nouns that is used in what is called the genitive case. A noun in the genitive case does one of two things. It either describes something about the head noun, or it shows what the head noun possesses. Here, the argument is for the latter. The head noun in the text is the scriptures. The scriptures possess encouragement for perseverance. If you are going to maintain your hope in the Lord Jesus Christ, it requires that you learn the Word of God. Christians are weak because they're ignorant. Testing 1, 2. You come across a weak Christian when you come across an ignorant Christian. An ignorant Christian is a Christian who does not know the Word of God, because they refuse to be taught the Word of God. The argument of the text is, how do you praise God with all believers? You can praise God with all believers when all believers are being taught the Word of God. If all believers are under the same teaching, we should have the same ideas. And when we have the same ideas, it should be easy for us to get along with one another. But when I decide whether or not I want to come to church, whether I decide whether or not I want to be taught the Word of God, or whether I just decide I can teach myself. That's foolish, and it's not biblical. You have to come to church to be taught the Word of God. Paul says the Word of God contains encouragement that allows us to persevere. You don't have to wait for God to come off his throne to slap you in the face to tell you what you need to do. Paul says, whatever God desires for you to do, you can find it in the scriptures. You can find it in the Word of God, because the Word of God possesses encouragement for perseverance. If that doesn't encourage you to read your Bible, I don't know what will. It's good to know that there's a word of encouragement inside the Bible. When I'm going through whatever it is I'm going through, there's somebody in the Bible that went through what I went through, and there's a story that tells me that God brought them out. Yes, and if God brought them out, and he's the same God today, yesterday, and tomorrow, then he'll bring me out too. There's encouragement in the Word of God. Yes, it is.
Yeah,
yes, there's encouragement in the Word of God. You just got to pick it up and read it.
Yeah, I think.
The Word of God doesn't do you any good sitting on your shelf.
Yes, sir.
A Bible app don't do you no good draining the battery in your phone. You got to pick it up.
Yeah.
And give it a try.
I
just tell you something about me. They say, you don't worry about nothing. You just always relax. My friend Brent tell me that, man, you don't worry about nothing, man. When I start worrying, I find me a Bible, and I sit down and I just get lost. Because when I get to thinking about the goodness of God and all that he's done for me, I forget about what I'm going For I know it, all my troubles are taken care of.
That's right.
Paul says, there's encouragement in the scriptures that we might have hope. There's hope in the word of God. Jesus is off the scene right now, but he left recorded in scripture that I go to prepare a place for you.
Amen.
That where I am there, you may be also. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would not have told you. And when I get tired of the world, I hold on to the promise of the word that Christ is coming back to get me. If, ladies and gentlemen, you are going to praise God with all believers, it requires that you learn the word of God. Paul ultimately reveals why it is that we should learn the word of God in verses 5 and 6. Paul says, now may the God who gives perseverance and encouragement give to you the same mind with one another according to Christ Jesus, so that with one accord you may be with one voice, glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul says that you and I should learn the word of God, so that when we come together as the body of Christ, we can all shout about the same thing.
That's it.
Listen. When you know that it was God who got you off your sick bed, and when somebody else knows that it was the same God who fixed their financial situation, and when somebody else knew that it was the same God that kept a roof over their head when they didn't have the funds to take care of their business, we can all shout together. Because although we have different situations, we all serve the same God. Paul says, 2 Timothy chapter 3, somewhere around verse 16, that all scripture is good for doctrine. All scripture is good for reproof. All scripture is good for instruction. All scripture is good for exhortation. Learning the word of God will help you to praise God with other believers. Help us shout all about the same thing. I'm good. But all I've been trying to tell you in this short time we spent together is that if you and I are going to praise God together with all believers, it requires that we endure the limitations of other believers. Not only does it require that we endure the limitations of other believers, it requires that we learn the word of God. Canada, I was a little 2-year-old girl who wandered away from home on a cold, snowy day when her parents realized that she was nowhere to be found. They alerted the neighborhood. The neighborhood, when they found out that this 2-year-old girl was missing, they went in every direction looking for the little girl. Several hours had passed and no one had found the little girl. When they all came back together, there was a man in the crowd saying, you know what we should do? We should all join hands and spread ourselves out, but don't let go of each other's hands. And we should all walk in a single file line so that way we can make sure that no ground goes uncovered.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
when they joined hands, they found the little girl.
All right.
But it was too late. She was curled up and buried in the snow. Someone lifted up their voice and said, only if we would have joined hands sooner, we could have saved a life. I stood up this morning, ladies and gentlemen, to let the church know that the church is losing potential candidates for salvation because we are too busy going separate ways. I don't want to see the day when the church loses a potential candidate for salvation and someone has to say, only if we would have joined hands sooner.
My Lord.
May God bless you. May God keep you.